Okay. All right. Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for coming. We're recording today so that if anybody would like to see our discussion later, they can always go to the library's YouTube page and watch. And if you have a question and you think, what were we talking about? What did we say? What did Mark say about that? You can always go in and look at the recording. So I'm going to go ahead and introduce you. And then if I say something wrong, you can correct me.
Okay, I know.
Okay, so this is our author today is Mark Pryor. He is a former newspaper reporter from England and now a prosecutor, defense attorney, right? With the, I'll tell that in a minute. His latest book is The Dark Edge of Night, which is currently checked out. It's the second in a series. This one is the first in the series. And it is set in Paris during World War II. Mark is also the author of the Hugo Marston mystery series set in Paris, London, and Barcelona. The first in the series, The Bookseller, was a Library Journal debut of the month and called Unputdownable by Oprah.com. And the series has been featured in the New York Times. Mark also wrote the highly praised psychological thrillers Hollow Man and Dominic. Dominic is right over there. As a seasoned prosecutor, he has tried and won multiple murder cases and appeared on CBS News' 48 Hours and Discovery Channel's Discovery ID Cold Blood. A year ago, he retired from the DA's office and switched sides. He's now a partner at a criminal defense firm. In his spare time, Mark is a dog-loving, soccer-playing husband and father to three children. So thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you for having me.
All right, so I have to say that I just recently read your newest series. He has two books in his latest series, the Henri Lefort series set in Paris, 1940. And they were so fabulous. I don't know if you guys have read them yet, but every time I would leave work and I wasn't with my family, I was reading them and I felt like I was living in Paris in 1940 during those couple of weeks that I was reading your books. So,
which isn't necessarily a good thing.
It's tense, but it was actually really fun and interesting. So, okay, first things first, can you tell us a little bit about your background, where you're from, what you do for a living, if you want to talk at all about that?
Yeah, so obviously I'm from England originally. My mom is from America, from North Carolina. So, I came out there in 1994 and fell in love with the place and ended up going to UNC Chapel Hill for undergrad, and then went to law school at Duke, met my wife, and she kind of brought me to Texas. Mm-hmm. I was a journalist for many years. Mm-hmm. And then I went to law school to become an FBI agent.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And then I graduated and they were like, you owe us $150,000. I'm like, well, I'm not going to be an FBI agent. It was soon after I got to Dallas, I actually started writing.
Really?
Because I got a job for one of those big law, awful, terrible mm-hmm. law firms mm-hmm. and hated it. And so I wanted to kind of not hate my life. So I thought, well, I'm going to try writing a novel. Mm-hmm. And so I wrote one and then tried to sell it and mm-hmm. got like 100-something rejections. And then I was mm-hmm. like, oh, I'll just write another one. Mm-hmm. Did that two more times. Mm-hmm. So I wrote three novels that never went anywhere.
When you tried to get it published, what are we talking about? Sending it out to like...
to agents.
How many agents were like a lot? Or
300 to 400.
Wow.
Yeah.
So you really tried with those. I mean,
I did. Yeah. But then I wrote The Bookseller mm-hmm. and then almost immediately got interest from many of the same agents.
Really?
Yeah. Hmm. Yeah. And in fact, I signed my longtime agent just retired. Mm-hmm. I was at some talk with her and I told her about this and she's like, I didn't know you wrote novels before The Bookseller. And I was like, yeah. Mm-hmm. So she said, well, send it to me. Maybe we can do something with it. And so I sent it to her and she emailed me back and she said, this is crap.
Oh.
But then like a couple of days later, she's known for being like very, she just speaks her mind, which mm-hmm. is very
good.
Helpful.
Yeah.
But she emailed me a couple of days later and said, hey, I didn't mean that this was crap. What I mean is you've come a long way as a writer since this.
That's a nice way to say it.
Could have started with that.
Well, a lot of us have to do like practice novels, right?
No doubt. Mm-hmm. No doubt. Right. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Do you feel like you did grow a lot as a writer?
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely.
When you go back and look at your...
I try not to. Yeah, I did look. When I went and looked at that one, I was mm-hmm. like, oh, it's like head hopping and like mm-hmm. bizarre red herrings. And yeah, mm-hmm. it was not great.
All right. How does your background, like your work or your, you know, your background living in Europe or your family life, how does any of that find its way into your fictional work?
I guess my job as a prosecutor is pretty useful. Because a lot of, I mean, my books are kind of, I guess, police procedurals, sort of, pretty much. And there's a very specific way of investigating crimes, which I'm familiar with. And I don't have to like do research or get stuff wrong because I know, you know, I've been involved in homicide investigations, so I know how that works. But, you know, sometimes people ask me if actual crimes make it into the books. But I guess I've probably worked on 20, 25 murder cases as a prosecutor and defense lawyer. And they're either too seedy, like just gross. A man strangles his wife because he's a jealous, abusive piece of crap. Or they're so ridiculous that you wouldn't believe it. I had a murder case where, if you can picture a recycling center with one of those long conveyor belts with people either side with the big gloves and they're separating all the paper and the plastic and the glass. And then, you know, somebody at this end kind of looks down and they're like, oh, who would put a mannequin in the recycling?
Oh, no.
And then somebody down a little bit closer is like, that's not a mannequin.
Oh, my gosh.
Which sounds like, I know you're all visualizing it. It sounds like a great start to a novel, right? So what happened was the detective, they call the detective, and the crime scene people are starting to clear off the conveyor belt so she can look at the body. And she's like, no, stop. And then she looks at the papers that are around the body, looking for envelopes or mail, so she can identify which, you know, roughly which part of town it came from, which is super smart. I mean, normally they just, they're not that always that clever. And sure enough, she was able to identify where the trash or the recycling can came from. They went to the area, they found it, there was blood in it, tested it, matched the body. Ooh, we have a crime scene.
Oh my God.
Which sounds great. Sounds like a really good start to a novel or a film or something. But then we live in Texas. We all know what we have next to our recycling can is a trash can. So if you put a body in a trash can, it goes to the dump and is never seen again. If you put a body in the recycling can, everybody's going to find it.
Right.
So if I write a novel where there's a guy standing there with a body over his shoulder trying to choose between the two, and he picks the recycling can, you're going to be like, no, that would never happen.
Right.
That would never, except it did.
It did.
Which is why we caught the idiot.
Wow.
But that's what I mean by, like, if I put stuff like that in a book, I had another case, a cold case that I prosecuted. Woman was bludgeoned in 1985. Case went cold for 20 years. And then the police got an anonymous tip from a woman who said, hey, it's this guy called Dennis. He used to date her. I know it's him. He told me something once. So the detective digs into the cold case and comes up with the written alibi of this guy, Dennis. Like it's a written alibi. Well, you know, again, the first thing that I couldn't put in a novel is the fact that the police never checked his alibi. Like it's the ex-boyfriend, written alibi. Oh, let's not check it. But they didn't. So the detective goes to, and the alibi was that he was with this woman overnight and so couldn't have done it. So the detective, Tom, he goes to this, he finds this woman. She's still in Austin and knocks on the door and says, hey, do you remember Dennis? And she says, yeah, we dated briefly. And he says, do you remember if you were with him? And this is in 2010.
Right.
He goes, do you remember if you were with him on the night of October 13th, 1985? She's like, no, of course I don't. That's ridiculous. How can I remember that? And he's like, well, I figured.
Yeah.
I'll try. And he starts to turn away. She goes, but you know, I did used to keep a diary. Would you like me to see if I still have it? Again, if that was in a novel, you'd be like, really? But she did. She went up, dug through boxes in her attic. Found the diary for that week and was like, oh no, I wasn't with him that night. That's the weekend I got back with my ex-boyfriend. And we introduced that diary into trial under the ancient documents exception to the hearsay rule, which the judge had never seen in 30 years, but that was cool. But like I say, if you put that in a novel, you'd be like, that's kind of stretching the...
Right.
And it turns out that the woman who made the anonymous phone call was his wife.
Really?
Yeah, to turn him in.
Whoa.
So, yeah, plot twist. Order say I use procedural knowledge of how to investigate stuff. But I had I was writing yesterday on the plane, and I wanted to know if a piece of certain type of evidence could be preserved for a long time. So I just texted a friend of mine who's a retired homicide detective and asked him. And he's like, yeah, that can happen. So that's useful.
It's nice that you have friends like that, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely.
Most of us are Googling it and probably getting flagged right by the FBI.
Oh, my search history.
Yeah.
Pretty bad.
I know. Can you tell us a little bit about your writing schedule? I have cockroaches also if you need any. I know you have a very full life, right? You have you work a lot, you have a family, and yet you find time to write these hugely successful book series. I was wondering if you could talk to us a little bit about like what your writing schedule is like each week, or where and when you write, that kind of thing.
Sorry, I went in the wrong pipe.
No, that's all right.
Yeah, I feel like, you know, I have friends who take 2 years to write a book. Cannot understand that. Mostly people who don't have a day job. I don't, how long does Terry take? She takes a year, right?
Yeah, she doesn't take long.
Oh, she's quick.
Well, compared to the rest of it, she seems quick to me.
Yeah. But I, as a former journalist and as a lawyer, I feel like I write quickly and quite like accurately. But typically, I'll do 2 or 3 hours on a Saturday and 2 or 3 hours on a Sunday.
Really?
Sunday, and that's pretty much it.
Okay, that's good. That's good news, right?
And then I'll do about 1,000 words an hour.
Okay, so you do 4,000 to 6,000 words a weekend.
Yeah, basically. If I'm diligent. Yeah.
Do you keep most of the words that you write? Yeah.
I do. I'll write and then I'll come back the next day and reread what I did the day before and edit that. And then write new words and then go back and kind of, you know, do it that way. So by the time I finish the first draft, it's pretty much a final draft.
Wow.
I don't, people say, you know, let yourself write a crap first draft. And that is completely okay. I just can't do that. You know, part of the reason is I hate editing. And to have something in writing and then have to go and like change it. And
yeah.
Because in a mystery novel, if you change things here, then it's going to affect what happens here and here and here. Yeah. And that's just so much work. Just I'm very lazy.
Writing 1,000 words an hour of pretty much capable words is impressive. Like, that's impressive.
Thank you. But I do spend a fair amount of time thinking about what I'm going to be writing, though. So if I'm driving to work and I'll have an idea, and I should have brought one. Actually, I have a book for every novel that I write, and I write ideas like what's coming next. And I have an idea when I begin each chapter of, okay, so this, what is, because every chapter, I think, for me, has to achieve something, whether it's introduce a character, plot twist, whatever, information, like a clue. Every chapter has to achieve something. Once I've figured out what that is, that chapter becomes really easy to write.
Do you outline, or are you a pantser? How do you?
Yeah, no, I don't.
Interesting.
I don't outline.
For mysteries, that's interesting. Yeah,
yeah, well, I tried. So when the bookseller, when I got my agent for the bookseller and she sold it to the publisher, she got me a 3-book deal, which at the time I was ecstatic about. The only problem was I'd only written the bookseller, which meant I had to write 2 more books. And then suddenly I've gone from being this idiot who just writes crap to a published novelist. And so in my head, it's like, oh, well, now I'm actually a writer. I have to do things writerly.
Yeah.
And so I got a notebook and I sketched out the second of the Hugo books.
Right.
And I had like spent 2 weeks about this priest who was driving around France and kidnapping people in his minivan and blah, blah, blah. And I sat down to write it, and the whole book is set entirely within Paris. There's no priest. There's no kidnapping anybody.
Right.
Like, it was a complete waste of my time.
So when you sat down to write it, that's just not what came out.
It's not what came out at all. I wasted paper in 2 weeks. And so what I'll do now is I start with, I know who dies, I know who killed them, and I know why.
Okay.
And then I kind of put that at the end and work towards it.
Do you write the end first?
No, no, I pretty much always write chronologically, but I just know where I'm headed. And then I'll divide in my little book. I'll divide the page up into each page into 6 squares, and I'll write what happened as I go along. So I'll be like the major points. So when I'm like, oh, when was that character introduced, or when was that clue dropped in, then I'll know.
Mm-hmm.
But that's going, you know, looking back and looking forward. What I try to do is have between 5 and 8, what I call them revelations.
Yeah.
Either a plot twist or some super surprise, mm-hmm. or some massive piece of information. And so, you know, I want to avoid the draggy bit of the middle book.
Right.
But if I have, like I say, 5 to 8 major revelations,
mm-hmm.
then I can work towards each one of those, mm-hmm. and keep the tension up.
Okay. So you said you divide up a page into 6 pieces, 6 squares.
For each chapter. Okay. And so I'll have like, and it's usually about 32 chapters.
Mm-hmm.
So, but then I can quickly look back at that and be like, oh, okay.
This is what the main point of this chapter is.
Yeah, exactly. And then I'll register what day of the week it is too, like, so I can keep track of my days.
Mm-hmm.
Because I guess there's no harm in admitting it amongst friends. In the new book, mm-hmm. I wrote, and this is funny how authors are so stupid sometimes. I wrote most of that book, and then I was reading about something in Paris in 1940.
Mm-hmm.
And it had to do with somebody walking past a store and seeing some Christmas trees,
mm-hmm.
and how in the beginning of the war, where they were so starved of everything,
mm-hmm.
like it meant so much to see these Christmas trees.
Mm-hmm.
And I loved that. And so I put it in the book. Mm-hmm. Well, but to put it in the book, I had to change the dates. But what I hadn't realized, or what I didn't clock, was I already had Henri having a conversation with an American about the American election.
Oh.
So previously it was before the election. In the book, it's after the election, but the conversation hasn't changed.
Oh, I didn't. That was what? In the second book?
Yeah.
I didn't catch
it. Yeah, see, one person is Peter. They're like, yeah, can I just ask? Wasn't. I was like, oh, God. But.
I didn't catch it. It didn't bother me.
You know what? It's I'm a human. We make mistakes. And it's the not editor my fault. Didn't my catch it.
Yeah, your publisher didn't catch it, right?
Fault.
Yeah.
Completely there. Like them.
So.
Yeah.
And you sometimes come here to write. Is that? Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I come here on Sundays.
Mm-hmm.
Thank bless you for being here on Sundays.
So, well, I have to say that you were coming here over the summer to finish the third book in the Henri Laforte series. And so we were having at the library, we were having a big event at the end of July for Harry Potter's birthday. And there were kids everywhere. There were balloons and cupcakes and kids screaming and running around. And then you were over in your area, like typing on your laptop, and then you left for the day, and all of the librarians looked totally shell-shocked. We were just like, you know, we'd had, I don't know how many hundreds of people here that day. Everybody was loud. And you left and you said, I just finished my latest book. And I said, oh, in the middle of all this, how do you focus if you're, I don't know how you focus. So,
that's an interesting thing, because I know, you know, I like the ambient noise of a library.
Mm-hmm.
Like, but I also have the same condition that
I was going to ask you about that.
Yeah.
Misophonia.
Mm-hmm. And for anybody who doesn't know, misophonia is a sensory condition where certain noises, if you hear them, they trigger you to, everybody has noises they don't like, but these kind of trigger a kind of a rage response. I was at a play for one of my kids once, and there was a kid behind me eating chips, doing nothing wrong, but eating chips. My wife was like, leave the building before you kill that child, because it was crinkling and it was just, and so I have that condition. My daughter has it.
Really?
We had to pull her out of high school.
Mm-hmm.
She phoned me once. She was in tears. She couldn't, like, the typing and the people eating and clicking pens. So she does online high school because she can't be around people. And she and I kind of bond over it. It's a terrible thing to have.
So it's do you all kind of understand what it is then? I'm here with my clicky. I'm going to put my clicky pen down, and I'll just go ahead and hold this instead. So
misophonia. Uh-huh. And so you will see this at some point.
Mm-hmm.
Everywhere I go, like on the plane for this trip, I have a pair of big ass headphones that I'll put on and play the music. We got an Uber from our hotel in Eugene yesterday to the airport.
Mm-hmm.
And it was funny because, and it's such a, almost a paranoia now, because we were in the car, and then anyway, we saw the Uber driver there,
mm-hmm.
and I said to my wife, he's chewing gum. She goes, it's okay, calm down. And so we get in the car, and sure enough, the guy chewing gum like that. And for me, that's actually ample reason to kill him. I literally would kill him. And so my wife was like, well, yeah, I'll sit in the front. We've got the bags. We'll just, and so I put my thing and I just stared out the window because I can't even see it.
You can't watch. You put your headphones on?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And he was trying to talk to me and Sarah's like, no. Just leave him alone.
Please don't talk to him.
Yeah. And so I'll do that on the plane. Mm-hmm. And if like I'm at Starbucks or if I'm here, there was something that happened and some guy was like clipping his nails or something. I know, gross, right? I actually took a picture of it and sent it to Sarah. I'm like, can you believe this guy? But I'll just put my headphones on and then shut everybody off. I'd rather not do that.
Yeah, but
because I like, you know, I like the sound of people coming in and like just ambient noise, but but I thought it'd be fun to give Henri that same condition.
And at one point, I think it's in the second book, his friend Mimi asks if it's because of he has really good hearing. Is that right? Is that something we're going to get into later?
No, maybe. But yes, that's something that I have is my eyesight slowly going, but my hearing is very, very good, very unfortunately. Good. But yeah.
You'd prefer it to be the other way around, maybe.
Well, you know, people always say, would you rather be blind or deaf? I'm like, deaf, sign me up right now.
Yeah.
That question's not even close.
I feel
But it's interesting because I've had conversations with people and they'll suddenly be like, oh my God, that's me. I get like literally. And the way I explain it to people is like, my wife is a vegetarian because she doesn't like meat or seafood. She won't eat fish because she doesn't like it. If you give seafood to my mother, she will die because she's allergic to it. So that's the difference between, because people are like, well, I have noises I don't like. I'm like, yeah, it's not, you don't actually want to kill people though. When, it's a thing. You may have it.
Yeah. We were having our writing class and someone was typing on their laptop right next to me and I was in a rage.
Well, and it's funny because people are doing perfectly normal things. Like my wife can't eat an apple in the same room or salad. Type in the same room as me, and all these poor human beings trying to live their lives doing normal things, and we're raging, trying to like, we're gonna kill you for that. It's so unreasonable, and yet.
But it's not just because you're trying to focus. It's just like you hate the sound.
Just you can't. Yeah, like I'll hear something, and I'll be the only one who hears it, or my daughter will hear it too. Mm-hmm. We're like, look at each other like, who's getting stabbed? And whoever it is not probably not doing anything wrong.
Right.
So.
Right.
But the other thing interesting to talk about misophonia, giving it to Henri, I realized that a lot of the things that trigger me didn't really exist back then. Keyboards? No.
Right.
Clicking pens? Mm-hmm. No. Mm-hmm. He has food, typewriters potentially.
Somebody in the movie theater is tapping their foot.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah. I had that a couple of weeks ago on a plane. This guy was enormous. His feet were like size 18 and he was like tapping it on that. I felt like the whole plane was shaking because this guy's huge feet. But because he's 6'7", what am I going to do about it? Right? And we're on a plane.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Yeah. Can you give us some context about your new series, Henri Lefort, when it's set and where and when it's set, and talk a little bit about how you chose to set the series there and then and what appeals to you about that setting?
Yeah, so the books are set right after the Germans move into Paris. As an Englishman, I think most of us, I don't know if the younger generations, we were just fascinated with the Second World War. Even though I wasn't alive for it, it's still a big part of my consciousness growing up. and I was a big fan of novels by Philip Kerr. I don't know if anybody knows those books. His main character is Bernie Gunther, who's a German police officer. They're all New York Times bestsellers, brilliant, brilliant books. And then he would come out here to Austin to do signings, and we got to be friends. Take him shooting and we go eat barbecue. And he was an interesting guy. But I told him like, I wanted to do this. He's like, we'll do it. I'm like, you're the best. I'm not going to do it. You know?
Yeah.
And then he died selfishly.
Oh,
I know. It gave me no notice whatsoever.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, it was very,
when did that happen?
Oh, it's probably 5 or 6 years ago now. yeah, I pretty much just had lunch with him at his club restaurant thing in London, and came back, and like 4 or 5 months later, it was cancer, of course. But then after he died, I was like, well, I'm just going to fill his shoes. I mean, you know, his feet are that big, mine are that big, metaphorically speaking. But like, and I know because of who he was, he would have found it hilarious that I was trying to capitalize on his readership.
Really?
And, oh my God. Yeah. He would have loved you. He would have loved that. But I just felt it kind of gave me license to do my thing. And I've kind of toyed with the idea of only meeting his character at some point.
Oh, that would be interesting.
I think so. Yeah. I don't know who I need to get permission from. Maybe his wife. I don't know.
Yeah.
But I just think it would be fun.
That would be really cool.
And so, yeah, I loved his books. And so I loved that period. It's such an interesting time to write about because like all the moral dilemmas you have in a regular mystery novel are amplified so much by you know, the Second World War. Like in the first book, when he's ordered to investigate the murder of a Nazi. And his position is, well, the more dead Nazis, the better. But it's his job. And so, you know, he has that moral dilemma about having to do his job to solve the murder of somebody he would quite like to see dead.
Right. So he's a police officer in Paris. And in the first book in the series, Paris has maybe 3 weeks before that has become occupied.
Yeah.
And so he can't just do his regular job. He's now being ordered to do certain things by the Germans who are occupying his city, which is not really his city anymore. It's very different now, right?
Yeah, there's a huge transition for everybody there. You know, in reality, millions of people left the city at the time, and then they kind of came trickling back over the next year or so. But the city itself changed. I mean, the Germans, I try to throw in little things that they did just to demonstrate. I think in the second book, I mean, they banned croissant, for heaven's sake. They literally had a ban on, I'll say it in America, the croissants. They banned, it's like, what? But it was a thing, they did it. And so I have a little scene where some guy is caught with the croissants.
Right, and a baker.
Yeah,
right, a baker.
Yeah, it's so ridiculous. But it's the kind of petty stuff that your life goes from being a homicide detective and you know, he's like top of the food chain,
right,
and all of a sudden he's not. He's terrified to get involved in some old boy who's been harassed for having a croissant.
Right Yeah, because he can't really do anything without risking his own life for this pastry, basically.
Exactly,
right?
It's just a weird time.
Do you want to talk some about, I mean, you do such an amazing job using details to bring this time and place to life, you know, the shortage of food and coffee and cars and his shoes. You know, at one point in the second book, Henri is, you know, he's having to walk everywhere pretty much because the cars have been, I guess, requisitioned. And so he's walking all over Paris and his shoes wear out. And it's, you know, it's winter and he's got a hole in the sole of his shoe and there's a shortage of leather as well. So he can't get it fixed. And so he flattens a cigarette packet, you know, cardboard to patch the hole. But you use all these, you know, very kind of little details, but they really bring that world to life. So what kind of research do you do to kind of bring this time and place to life?
I do. Sadly, for every book I set in Paris, I kind of feel like I have to go there.
Oh.
Thank you very much for your sympathy. I know it's sincere. I do, especially for the Hugo series where it's set in modern times, I go. Research is real easy online. Like if I want to know what street, like how do I get him from A to B, I can do Google Maps. But I've always found that going there is very inspiring. Like I don't, when I describe Paris, whether it's in the old, you know, Hugo series or this one, I don't describe the Eiffel Tower or the you know, Notre Dame or anything like that, because everyone knows what that looks like. So it's for me, it's the small details. I was there one time walking actually to the train station to get my mom who was coming to spend a few days there. And it was a fairly ordinary walk, not very interesting. And then suddenly I turned right into this pedestrian street that was cobbled. And there was, on my right, there was like a wine shop and then there was a cheese shop next to that. And then on my left, there was a little cafe restaurant and the owner was standing on the steps smoking his first cigarette of the day. And I was like, this is perfect. And mm-hmm. then I looked up, and then around the corner at the top of this mm-hmm. little street, this very pretty girl comes on a bicycle with like her scarf and her hair flying behind her. And she's pulling a wheeled suitcase as she's, you know, coming from the air, from the train station on her bicycle. I'm like, and I was thinking to myself, like, I could go on Google Maps and see this street. I would never have seen that image mm-hmm. if I hadn't been there. Mm-hmm. And of course, I just pick it up and put it straight in the book.
Directly there, yeah. But
that's what, you know, mm-hmm. puts you in Paris. Mm-hmm. Like I think in this book, I was doing a lot of reading, and mm-hmm. and some of it's almost you. So there's a blackout in Paris, so they can't have the streetlights. But the streetlights are still there, so they found that people were walking and crashing into them. And so they ended up having to wrap, the Germans were wrapping the streetlights with padding so that the locals who they're oppressing mm-hmm. wouldn't crash into them or walk into them and hurt themselves. Let's ban croissants, wrap the street lampposts. It was just, but it's little touches like that that I think put you in in a book. Like, and I think in the last Hugo book I wrote, I was just down in this, I was there doing my little research. And I noticed that over the years, every time you're in the metro, there are always, you know, same as here, there are people panhandling for money.
Right.
But the little schemes they have to get your attention change. Hmm. You know, sometimes it's music. For a while, it was them with their kids, which is pretty disturbing. But the last time I was there, I noticed that, like, it seemed 80% of the panhandlers had little bunny rabbits with them.
Oh.
I know, right? And it's like, oh, that's so cute. And I said to my wife, I said, well, at least they got lunch.
Oh, God. She didn't find
one. But it was like, they'd all decided, oh, yeah, if we get bunny rabbits, we'll get people's attention. They'll give us money.
Mm-hmm.
And so, mm-hmm. again, I'm like, if I hadn't gone,
right,
I wouldn't know that.
Right.
And so I picked that up and put it straight in the book.
Yeah. I'm not going to say any spoilers, but in the first Henri book, you have kind of two mysteries going. You have the World War II era mystery, and you have Henri's backstory, which is set in World War I. I heard a little bit about how you restructured the book to fit the two mysteries in, and I wanted to ask you about that, restructuring it, but also if you read very much set in World War I as well.
Yeah, I love World War I. It's been interesting to me since. So I grew up on a farm in England, mm-hmm. And my other members of my family were in the village.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't really tell the story without sounding a little obnoxious, so my apologies. One of the people who worked for my grandparents, mm-hmm. one of the gardeners, had fought in World War I,
mm-hmm.
and he signed up when he was like 15 years old.
Mm-hmm.
But he retired, he was getting old and sick, and he didn't have any family to look after him, so we took him in and basically took care of him until he died.
Hmm.
But in his last year or two, he would just lie in bed, and I'd take him cups of tea, and he'd tell me stories from the First World War.
Oh, wow.
And so a couple of things that happened in this book are literally hmm. taken from Joe. And I think I credit Joe mm-hmm. in the acknowledgements mm-hmm. with some of his stories.
Wow.
Because it's just fascinating. It's just mm-hmm. horrific, the stuff that they went through.
Mm-hmm.
And then, yeah, and so initially I'd written it as two timelines, like jumping back and forth.
Yeah.
And my agent was like, I like what's happening here and what's happening here. Is right. there a way to, like, not do the jumpy thing?
Right.
and that actually solved two problems. One stone?
Mm-hmm.
Sure. Why not?
Yeah.
because one of the things I realized, and I hadn't realized because I'd never written historical fiction before, if you read my Hugo books now, you'll know that I like to have sort of strong, intelligent women
right.
in my books.
Yeah,
that's harder to do in historical fiction, just because you can't have a woman detective.
Mm-hmm.
You can't have like a woman boss necessarily. Like, they're just, you may not know this, mm-hmm. but men were shitty back then and made women not be very prominent.
Hmm.
Thankfully, that doesn't happen anymore.
Sure.
But it made finding a you know, strong, intelligent woman who could mm-hmm. you know, impose herself on the story a challenge. And then mm-hmm. I was doing some research, and I came across Princess Marie Bonaparte,
mm-hmm.
who lived in Paris, the great 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 niece mm-hmm. of the little man himself. And she was a fascinating character. Mm-hmm. And I ended up buying her biography and reading it. She was very intelligent, very independent. She was married, but she didn't really care about that. she was big into psychotherapy. What did they call it back then? I forget what they called it back then. I'm still sick. Mm-hmm. Anyway, so she studied with Freud mm-hmm. and she actually helped Freud escape to London. Mm-hmm. But then and then stayed in living in Paris. So I have her connecting with Henri. Mm-hmm. And she's super interested in him. She can tell there's something not right. She's interested in the misophonia. Mm-hmm. And so basically she, because she's wealthy, she bribes him with food and wine mm-hmm. to sit down with her and tell her his story. Mm-hmm. And so we get the kind of flashbacks mm-hmm. Told, he's sitting there telling her in real time, mm-hmm. you know, this happened, this mm-hmm. is, you know, who mm-hmm. who I really am, mm-hmm. what really happened. And so it becomes his person.
His roommate.
Yes. Uh-huh. That's another choice.
Yeah.
Damn it. and Marie, who he calls Mimi, uh-huh. they become the only people who know his secret.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Which is fun to have in a series because then I can let it out.
Yeah.
In the second book, I think they tell mm-hmm. Daniel.
Daniel, yeah.
Who's not a real character, but his brother was. Mm-hmm. I mentioned Jean Moulin.
Right.
Mm-hmm. He was a prefect in one of the districts in one of the leading resistance mm-hmm. fighters
right.
in the Second World War.
Yeah.
Which didn't end well for him, but... Mm-hmm.
I was going to ask you about using, because you do have some real life people. So you have Mimi, Marie Bonaparte. You have Virginia Hall,
yes,
right, who is a real life person. So you have some real people from history and you put them into this fictional story. I was going to ask you kind of how do you blend, you know, your research with your imagination and how true to life are the characters? I mean, I'm not going to
totally fault you for that. Yeah. Well, that's the thing, right? Because, you mm-hmm. know, so in the first book, I have Picasso.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And the apartment that I have him in is mm-hmm. his actual apartment.
Oh.
And he's kind of a weird dude in some ways because mm-hmm. he has in his apartment this hook, this iron hook mm-hmm. that was used when there was an assassination attempt in whatever year it was. They caught the guy who was trying to kill the king and they hung him from this hook and tortured him for... horribly for weeks, but Picasso was like, oh, I want that hook in my apartment, and he had it. but it's fun to think about, right? Because, you know, you think you can read Picasso mm-hmm. his biography, or you can look at his paintings and you can know bits about him mm-hmm. and so it's fun to fill in the bits in between with your imagination. Mm-hmm. What, you know, what was his position on the resistance? Like, mm-hmm. what did he give crap about curfew? Did he follow curfew? What, like, what was he doing?
Right.
And so, you know, when I bring real characters in, I try to fill in those bits that you don't know mm-hmm. with maybe true, maybe probably isn't true, mm-hmm. but it's consistent with him. Likewise, Virginia Hall, you know, that and something with writing this new series is mm-hmm. that I've discovered is so much about the Second World War I don't know. Mm-hmm. Like, I thought I knew a lot, mm-hmm. but the more I read and research, the more I realize I didn't know. Mm-hmm. And because I don't know how I got to the age of late 30s, don't laugh, without hearing about Virginia Hall. And if you haven't heard of her, mm-hmm. she was an American who wanted to be a diplomat, was denied, because she was a woman. and one of the first things she did after that was she shot her own foot off in a hunting accident. I know. But then she became one of the leading spies for the French in the Second World War, to the point where that she was the number one woman hunted by the Nazis, and she escaped on foot, because she only had one. Across the Pyrenees, literally on foot, mm-hmm. Got to England, mm-hmm. and then was sent back as a spy for the English, mm-hmm. and survived the Second World War, like two separate, and so there's a book called A Woman of No Importance mm-hmm. about Virginia Hall, mm-hmm. and I read that, I was like, I have to have this woman. Mm-hmm. And she makes a fleeting appearance.
I really hope she comes back. For what it's worth, I loved her. So
yeah, she Henri thinks he's he's flirting with her a little bit. Mm-hmm. I don't mind giving this away because it's funny to write. Because mm-hmm. so he's at a cafe. Mm-hmm. She sits down next to him and he feels like somebody rubbing his leg. Mm-hmm. And he's like, ooh, Okay. And he kind of does it back a little bit. And then finally, he looks over and she's adjusting her fake leg. And so she has no idea what she was doing. And he's like, oh, God. But that was fun to write.
That was really good. In these books, you have kind of a balance between good and evil. I mean, Henri is faced with some pretty wicked people, you know, these Nazis committing horrific crimes. And he's living through a really trying time. He doesn't know if the Nazis will win. He doesn't know if the Paris he loves is gone forever. And yet somehow you instill these books with kind of a feeling of goodness. It's not all, you know, really dark. You know, he'll go from experiencing something really horrific, and then in the next chapter, he's in his apartment eating some soup and telling his roommate about what happened. And I never feel like, you know, I always feel like we're safe, kind of, even though he's, you know, he's always flirting with danger. I always feel like we're kind of safe. So I didn't know if you could talk a little bit about how you balance kind of that darkness with kind of this feeling of goodness also.
Yeah, I mean, I think all books, all novels, you have to have the light with the dark and the funny with the serious and the, you know, those light moments just to, otherwise it's kind of depressing. But also try to think about what it's like to have been living back then.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, we sit back now and like I was reading a book yesterday on the plane about the serial killer in Paris.
Mm-hmm.
And it, you know, had like a March 1944. And in my head, I'm like, okay, so there was just another year and a couple months and then the war ended. But when you're in March in 1944, you don't know that.
Right.
Like he's in 1940.
Mm-hmm.
His city's taken over. He has no clue when, if ever, it's going to end.
Right.
And so I have to kind of put myself in that mindset and not be like, oh, well, he's got, you know, as a writer, I'm like, well, I have to set a book every couple months because I know the war's going to end.
Yeah.
And then I'm out of material. but for him, he doesn't know that. Mm-hmm. And so I think, like in my head, I think it's the third book I just finished where somebody says they're talking about, you know, we have to hang on to hope because right now it's all we have.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's true of in that situation where people have to be kind of true to themselves. Like he's fundamentally a good person. Mm-hmm. Nicola's fundamentally a good person. Right. So with all the bad stuff happening around them, they're kind of hanging on to who they are.
Mm-hmm.
And which is why he does, you know, he questions having to investigate the death of a Nazi, but he does it because it's like, well, that's my job.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, nobody gets to kill people for free
right.
on my watch.
Right.
And that's that's part of him hanging on to who he is.
Mm-hmm.
And I, you know, that's going to be a recurring theme in the books.
Mm-hmm.
And with a kind of counterbalance of, okay, but what can I do to get things back to how they were?
Right.
And in the second book, you see the kind of emergence of the resistance.
Yeah.
And his first tentative steps towards helping them.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I think, you know, living as normal as they can, being as decent as they can be,
right,
is super important to everybody back then.
Right. Right. It's interesting that you started writing this at the beginning of the pandemic, right? Is that right?
Right before, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I'm just talking about, you know, not knowing how long a terrible situation is going to last. So
yeah, that's true. Actually, so this book I wrote, finished it before the pandemic. And then when that hit, I was completely unable to write. Like I couldn't, and that was true of several of my friends. I couldn't create anything.
Yeah.
But it was the point where my agent was like, hey, we should chop and change, and you know, I could edit apparently.
Okay, that's good.
But
yeah.
I couldn't write. Yeah. So that was
you could work with.
Yeah. So. Thank heavens I'd actually written it.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah.
How do you envision this series going forward? Do you want to write a lot in this series? And
I do. Mm-hmm. I do. Yeah. I'd like to keep going through the rest of the war. Mm-hmm. I just started a new book a few weeks ago, about almost halfway through, actually.
Really?
I know. Well, the reality that...
That's... You started it a few weeks ago?
Yeah.
And you're almost halfway through?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, more like a third, to be fair. Right.
Fine.
Because the reality is, whether or not I get to keep the series depends on how the sales are. And the sales were good enough of the first one to warrant a third one. But I don't know if, you know, I now have to wait for probably a year.
Oh, to see if you can write.
To see if I can write a fourth one. And so I'm like, well, I said to my agent, I'm like, what am I, do I just write a fourth one just in case? And she's like, is there something else?
Yeah.
And so I talked to my editor, at St. Martin's, and she's like, you know what's selling right now is mysteries with female protagonists set today. And I was like, oh, okay. I had written a TV series I'd created with Philip Kerr. We'd created this together. And then when he died, it kind of fell off. But then about a year ago, I wrote a pilot of like a screenplay pilot, gave it to my agent. So I have a new agent, the other one retired. The new one does a lot more TV. If you've heard of Judy Bacall, the writer?
Yeah.
Yeah. We now have the same agent.
Oh, wow.
I know. I know Jody is very impressed. She shares an agent with me. Yeah. But anyway, she does almost
TV. Can I ask you, I'm sorry, how did you switch when your agent was retiring?
She knows this current agent.
Okay.
And she thought we'd get along. And then we had a Zoom. We got on a Zoom to introduce us. And my new agent, Laura, is English, but lives in America. So we have a whole similar thing going on. And at one point I looked at the Zoom and my retiring agent was sitting there with this like big smile on the face. She's like, yeah, those two are getting on. It works.
Yeah.
So I showed this thing to Laura, and she showed it to Amazon, and they were like, oh yeah, we really like it. I was like, oh, okay. Just open up my bank account and sit back for a minute. And then she phones me and she goes, okay, so is anyone way to say this? I'm really sorry. They're not buying things from white men right now.
Wow. They're not buying things from white men right now.
Yeah. And so I was like, I thought about it. But I was like, you know, all right, we've had a good run. I'm not going to be mad about it. But then when I talked to my editor about something, she goes, well, why don't you write that as a book? And it's based on when I was a prosecutor, for about 4 years, every Thursday night, I would do ride-alongs.
Oh, cool.
With APD. So they'd pick me up at the DA's office at 5 o'clock, and then we'd ride along to 11 or 12. And then I'd have Fridays off to write. Perfect.
Wow.
And it was nice, the best time of my week.
Yeah.
And it was so interesting. It was so fun. And so when Phil Kerr came out and I was telling him about it, he's like, oh, we need to write a TV series about this, you know, female prosecutor who does these ride-alongs and has all these adventures. And I was like, yeah. And he goes, well, what should we call it? And I'm like, I don't know. He goes, well, tell me more about it. And I said, well, right now I'm writing out in Charlie Sector. And he's like, that's the title, Charlie Sector. That's the book that I've started.
Okay.
And it was weird because I wrote the pilot and I've been thinking about it for 5 or 6 years because it fell. I was writing, I'm like, this is really stupidly easy. I bet it's terrible. And so I did what I'd never done before. I emailed it to the first 6 chapters to Laura, my agent. I was like, is this any good? Like, she's like, oh, this is compelling. Keep going.
Right. But that was as a screenplay.
It was originally as a screenplay or a pilot, I guess, technically. Okay. But now I'm just turning into a novel. And then Austin has 8 sectors. So I figure there's an 8-book series at least.
Wow. Okay, so you say I just turned it into a novel. Like, it's an easy thing to turn a pilot into a novel. But I don't know. I mean, most of us probably, you know, write in one genre and don't switch so much. So, but you find it okay to switch?
Yeah, I mean, I've never really written for TV or anything, but I found that fairly easy to write. And then because I had all the plot ready to go and the characters, it was almost just like transcribing. It was almost like not writing, it was like typing, which is why I was worried that it was terrible because it was just too easy.
Right.
But yeah, no. So in the meantime, I mean, my ideal life would be give up the practice of law and write one of these and then a Charlie Sector every year, like do two books a year.
Wow. Well, you know, maybe if the book does really well, then it'll get
like up. Literally if everybody in here bought 8,000 copies,
Okay.
I could do that.
All right. We can do this, guys.
Yeah. It doesn't seem unreasonable.
It's fine. We can do it. We can make it happen. So when you were doing the ride-alongs, is that something that you could do because of your job, or was it something that other people
So my boss, the elected DA at the time, I think there'd been some tension between the DA's office and the police.
Mm-hmm.
So she she asked for volunteers for a prosecutor in each of the sectors,
mm-hmm.
to be like the sector prosecutor.
Hmm.
And then she said, look, I need you guys to ride out mm-hmm. as often as you can.
Mm-hmm.
We get comp time for it. So I'm like, yeah,
great.
Every Thursday evening.
Yeah.
Fridays off, 3-day weekend. It was great.
That sounds really cool. Yeah. Really cool. Okay, so when you're writing a series, do you feel like you're consciously, and you want the series to be kind of a long series, do you feel like you're consciously like planting little seeds in your first books or your second books to kind of like explore in future books? Or
I didn't with the Hugo books because I guess I did towards the end, but initially I didn't, because if you remember that I wrote three that went nowhere.
Yeah.
And then so when I wrote the bookseller, I had no expectation it would go anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't really do that for that book. But now I'm much more conscious of that, especially mm-hmm. for this series, like creating mm-hmm. characters that I know
mm-hmm.
are going to last. In fact, the novel I just turned in, the third one, in the synopsis for my editor, I had one of the major characters dying.
Oh.
And she was like, nope. Nope, you need to create another character and kill them,
mm-hmm.
but you cannot kill this particular character.
We're going to need them.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Which, I was fine with. Mm-hmm. They're very hands-off creatively.
Mm-hmm.
And I understood. She wasn't literally no. She was like, please think about it because mm-hmm. X, Y, and Z. In the Hugo series, I actually do kill off a major character mm-hmm. in book three, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And I was accosted at a book event by a reader who was so upset by that. It was kind of weird, but I explained to her, look, if you have a series, mm-hmm. and it, pretty much every series, of every mystery series or thriller, the main one or more of the main characters are going to be in jeopardy,
mm-hmm.
right? But if you have 15 books, and in every single book, they're in major jeopardy and nothing ever happens.
Right.
There's no tension.
Right.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
But now if you read one of my books, you're like, oh my God, he killed that character.
Mm-hmm.
And then I do kill a significant character in the third book.
Mm-hmm.
Then it kind of heightens the tension because, mm-hmm. I'm prepared to kill characters.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. So I want to open it up to you all as well. If you all have questions for Mark, I know we're it's almost 2:00 and I don't want to go too much over, but I do want to ask you if you all have questions. Yeah.
I have one. Oh, I have a lot, actually.
Oh, I know.
And also, just so we can, we may need to repeat the question so that the recording can hear.
Okay.
I was curious, when you have a real person like Picasso or some of the others that you've mentioned, and you make something up about them, who do you have to clear it with? With Picasso, probably no one. Maybe, I don't know. But some of the other characters, do they have interested parties that are going to come up and say, you can't put that in your book?
Do you want to repeat
that? Okay, so when you're writing a character who is a real life character from history, who do you have to clear it with? Like if you're writing about Picasso, for instance, is somebody going to object to you writing about him doing something? Who do you have to clear it with? So
that's an interesting question. Mm-hmm. I guess being a lawyer helps with the answer. there are two ways I could get in trouble. One would be if I say something defamatory, libelous about that person, call them a child molester, or say they killed somebody when they didn't. Then in theory, I could be sued for libel, defamation. But that problem goes away when the person I'm writing about is dead. They can't sue me for that because they're dead. Plus I haven't done that and I wouldn't do that. The only other issue I would potentially run into would be is if I'm taking over somebody's life story and profiting off their life story, which again, I'm not doing. I'm just using a snapshot into history and making some stuff up. So the short answer to your question is nobody. I can see a family member, if I'm rude or disrespectful about somebody, sending me an angry email, but there's no legal recourse and there's no prohibition to me doing any of that.
Good to know.
Yeah. So feel free to. And if the person is a bad person in real life, then nobody cares, right?
What other questions do you all have? Anybody? No, we could keep talking for a long, long time. But yeah, Jane.
Can you tell us more about your notebook where you keep ideas during the thinking process before you buy?
Okay. Yeah, I wish I'd brought.
Yeah, the I was going to say the notebook. The question was, can you tell us more about the notebook that you use when you're writing?
I meant to bring it, but I was a scatterbrain this morning. Yeah, so the first page I'll have titles, potential titles. And then I'll keep in that notebook, I'll keep a list of characters because I hate, like, I always forget. I'm like, who was that German again? Was it Gerhardt or, you know, and I just keep a list of characters. I'll have a list of events that I know are going to happen. I just don't know when. Mm-hmm. And often those are going to be my revelations, like wow, that happened. But I don't necessarily worry about them being in order. Mm-hmm. I'll have those divided, those six cubes in each page to track the book as I write it. And then just random ideas that come into my head mm-hmm. or a turn of phrase that I like, a description of something. And then I'll have a page where I know that I need to loop back to some event. Like I've dropped something in. Mm-hmm. Don't forget,
mm-hmm.
this character went to this restaurant for a reason.
Right.
Go back to that.
Right.
And a lot of it is a bit like having a teddy bear. It just makes me feel better when I'm writing.
It's comforting.
I can just look at this stuff and be like, okay. Keep going. You're doing well.
You're doing fine.
Yeah. Anti-writer's block. Although somebody once asked me they asked me to write a blog post about writer's block.
Mm-hmm.
And at the time I was like, dude, I have a full-time job, 3 kids. I don't have time for writer's block.
Yeah.
And that's kind of how I feel.
You just got to get it out.
Just got to do it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, you know, and somebody in the audience and I were talking before you arrived that, you know, the books themselves, the stories are so engaging, the plot is, you know, riveting, but also just like on a, you know, page by page, paragraph by paragraph, sentence by sentence level, the writing is just really beautiful. So I think it's you're very talented.
Well, thank you.
Yeah.
Can I have that in writing?
We're recording it.
So. Yeah, there you go. It's good enough. Yeah, I'm much better than those first 3 books that I wrote. If I showed you one of those, you'd be like, oh my God. Although the story was good. The mm-hmm. first initial story was set in Dallas on the White Rock Lake,
mm-hmm.
and the murder I thought was super ingenious.
Mm-hmm.
It was the murderer was an ice sculptor,
mm-hmm.
and basically what he did was he created an ice coffin and then sealed his victim in it, so she suffocated, mm-hmm. and then he just pushed it out into the lake, so it slowly melted,
mm-hmm.
and then her body was found, and there was no signs of trauma or any, no mm-hmm. drowning, nothing. No one could figure out how she died.
Wow.
Because she was isn't that great?
It is good. Yeah. I mean you could use it in a future. Use it, maybe. Yeah.
Yeah,
you could still use it.
She has a kid just to write, like informally or always write.
Yes.
Did you write as a kid?
I did. It's funny you should ask that. It's almost like I blunted the question, which I actually didn't. So I remember mm-hmm. in primary school, which is your elementary school, I had a teacher, Mrs. Garwood, and she gave us 2 books. One was, I think, green, one was blue, pink, whatever, what doesn't matter. One was for if news,
mm-hmm.
like, so if something happened, we'd write, you know, about whatever it was that happened. And one was for stories, like made mm-hmm. stuff up.
Mm-hmm.
And then we got back from a summer holiday 1 year, and I told you I live on a farm.
Mm-hmm.
So she said, okay, everyone get out your news book and write down something that you did in the summer.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was like, oh yeah, here we go. And I was like, I wrote about how I was playing on the farm with my best friend, and we were playing on a haystack, and then we got attacked by alligators, and I had to fight them off with a stick, and I saved my best friend from being eaten by alligators. Mm-hmm. And this was in my news book I was writing this. And I don't know if you know this, but there are not really any alligators in England. And there were none on my farm. But I remember her response to that was to give me a gold star. And it didn't, obviously I was a kid at the time, so it didn't really count. But it was like, that was my first encouragement to be like, yeah, that's a good story. I don't care that it's in the wrong book.
Yeah.
Tell the story. Mm-hmm. And you know, since then, you know, when I was living in Chapel Hill, I would write short stories, but never really did anything with them. And then as a journalist, you know, I've always enjoyed writing. So, but it wasn't until I got to that job in Dallas, I was like, I'm going to sit down and write a novel.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then, you know, my message to anybody here who is writing a novel, I bet I got more rejections than you ever will. and you know, my wife would be like, what are you doing? Like, how do you, I'm like, yeah, every rejection is one step closer to acceptance.
Right.
Like, yeah. I'm in a cult.
Right. No, I mean, if you get hundreds of them, it's yeah. like.
But then, you know, there is no feeling in the world like walking into a bookstore and seeing your novel on the shelf. You know, anybody can self-publish. That's easy. And nowadays isn't necessarily a bad way to go at all.
Mm-hmm.
But just to walk in now, and like if I go to the local Barnes & Noble, I have my own little section because I have like 13 books.
Right.
There's a P and then there's a PR and it's me.
Yeah.
Which I'll just go in there and stand and grin to myself for a couple minutes and then leave.
Yeah.
Because it's cool. Well, I think about all those rejections and
yeah. Makes it worth it.
Yeah, it's been a journey. Yeah. But it's 100% worth it. And mm-hmm. and so of course the message is don't give up.
Yeah.
Like just because you get a mere 50 rejections.
Yeah.
It could be that whatever you're working on isn't the thing that will get published, mm-hmm. but keep going.
Good advice. Well, thank you so much for coming today. We really appreciate talking to you.
Me.
Yeah. We look forward to seeing you writing in
I'll
the library.
Be, yeah, some days I'll be here.
All right. Thanks. Thank you very
much.
Thank
you guys for coming.
And please feel free to stay and eat something if you'd like.
I know.
And,
you know. I'll try not to breathe on
this
people.
This is great. When I've read the others, but this I need you to read now.
Really. I'll give you to read it too. Oh, yeah.